LPL can lose games without actually stepping foot on the Rift.
Yeah, exactly.
And
right.
They're second and third, which is a very scary prospect. But we're already in LeBlanc as well as Ahri being taken away from Snake, and a Xerath and a Nidalee ban being taken away by Energy Pacemaker.
The Nidalee ban is interesting. Beast has played it a couple of times, I believe, but it hasn't really been one of his standout champions. Just generally strong, you could imagine that Energy Pacemaker probably just don't want to deal with it.
Yeah, and Nidalee is one of those champions right now that she lands one spear at the 30-minute mark and it completely turns the game on its head.
Yep.
Just with all of that damage. Diana also being banned away, so maybe mid, maybe top.
Yeah, that's an
Papa
interesting...
Papa Smithy assures me that it's a good jungle pickup.
You played it yesterday, and it was a good jungle pickup. Thank you very much for the carry. Rek'Sai going to be banned away here as well. Snake not going to be taking that one. And they now have the opportunity to first pick potentially that Victor, or maybe the Maokai, which is what they've been going for every other time.
And no bans towards Crystal. This is really strange. The Juggernaut composition is fully open. However, they do elect for something a little bit more standard, lock in that Victor, and that means Amazing J can lock in the Hecarim.
Oh, dear. Or the Garen, of course, which is also an important pickup. Drizzle hovering over the Nunu here. And you have to think, Amazing J probably not going to pick anything other than the horse if he has,
Amazing
if he has
J's
the opportunity.
Amazing J's coach just hit him when he when he went over to the Garen. He had a little bit of a cheeky smirk.
Oh, interesting.
So maybe a Juggernaut comp coming through from Energy Pacemaker here.
Yeah, very interesting. Although Snake, they definitely know the jig is up now for Energy Pacemaker, because Lulu Nunu, that screams hyper carry. That screams, let's put someone who does heck of a lots of damage in the front line and make them huge. So Snake, they have the opportunity to A, pick away the Kog'Maw if they want to, or B, opt to try and counter it with something that they understand, because of course they've played this Juggernaut comp. They know where it's strong and where it's weak.
And this is the thing, I'm not convinced that Juggernaut just revolves around the Kog'Maw. I'm pretty confident that if you ran it with another hyper carry, you would be able to, I guess, get as much work done as you would with the Kog'Maw, but it looks like they're going to allow them to pick it up. They've gone with the Jarvan as well as the Kalista, and we'll see exactly how Energy Pacemaker respond. If they go Morgana Kog'Maw here, then that is definitely the composition they're running.
Yeah, and is this Kalista and the Jarvan actually going to help them counter that one out? Is Raphael hovering over some interesting champions here? We'll see whether that actually does come through. But Kane, looking at possibly a Morgana. Oh my goodness, don't hover that, Varus. Don't play with my heart. As it is going to be the Hecarim locked in.
Yeah, so Hecarim locked in. That'll be in the top lane. So it's a mid lane Lulu. See how that fares against Bucca's Victor in the mid lane. So it doesn't look like a full-blown Juggernaut composition. There is definitely an element there of being able to protect it. Of course, you have to remember the speeds up. All the added shields that come through will also help Hecarim out terrifically in the mid game. Hecarim Lulu is so good. You get the big five-man ultimates through from Hecarim and then able to pop everyone into the air and see exactly how they want to play this one out. Now, Shu, the last pick, is going to pick up an AD carry. You would expect it to be the Kog'Maw. In response, a Maokai as well as a Thresh being locked in. They're lacking a little bit of damage on Snake's lineup, you have to think.
Yeah, although Kalista, a lot of AoE, of course, the Victor as well going to have a lot, but you're exactly right. I mean, Maokai, Jarvan, they're going to be tanky. They're going to be doing what they can to try and, you know, peel for their carries. But when it's a Victor who's so incredibly squishy, I'm not entirely sure. But Energy Pacemaker thinking about a stand behind a big old Jinx comp.
Yeah, and I like it. As I said, I'm not convinced that Juggernaut is exclusive to the Kog'Maw. And Protect the AD carry comps have been around for ages. And this is just a little bit of a Protect the AD carry comp. And Jinx, in my opinion, is the best hyper carry in the game.
With the AoE? That make, what makes
it's the long range rockets. It's the fact that you can poke from afar with that zap, and it's such a strong slow for chasing people down. But the real turning point of her kit is a get excited. Kog'Maw takes people off the Rift and does it extremely quickly, but doesn't really have that speed up steroid. You throw a Lulu on top of a Jinx who's already flying around top speed. It's just hard to hit any skill shots, and really believe that those Flame Chompers also add something further to her kit. She's like a Kog'Maw without the percentage damage, but a lot better CC. And when you have all these shields, the Blood Boil as well as the Lulu help picks augmenting all of your damage, she's going to be absolutely terrifying.
Yeah, you also have an AoE global execute as well, which is just completely ridiculous. But as we have a look over the lineups, Amazing J on the horse against the tree in the top lane. Beast, He's going to be playing Jarvan against Nunu, of course. Knows those champions very, very well. And we'll see how Drizzle fares on the Nunu. Barker does have a champion he's comfortable with. This is definitely important, but we'll see whether Raphael can sort of equalize that lane as Lulus tend to do. In the bottom lane, this is the exciting bit.
Yeah, this is definitely an exciting bit. We're seeing the Crystal Ella on the Thresh as well as the Kalista, and that's such a dangerous lane. Probably expect a lane swap to come through. But Jinx Janna, also very good at counter pushing and has extreme range to get some harass down.
Yeah, well, this is the thing. And Crystal, I mean, he's on the Kalista, so doesn't have a whole lot of range to play with early on. And you're going to get that switcheroo up first, and Kane's just going to be able to rocket his face off.
Yeah, exactly right. Able to harass as Crystal is sitting on the minion wave, the caster creep wave, so we'll be able to push as well.
Yeah, but ladies and gentlemen, let's get onto the Rift. And here we are, ladies and gentlemen, with Snake taking on Energy Pacemaker for our first game of the last day of the LPL here for week 9. We're, of course, getting down to the business end. And Energy Pacemaker have the first Jugger Jinx comp? This sounds really weird.
You can call it whatever you want. It's just a little bit of a protect the AD carry comp with Amazing J taking the Hecarim. So there's definitely two threats on the team. Can't underestimate the damage that late game Lulu does as well after she picks up that Lich Bane.
Yeah, and actually Pawn demonstrated that yesterday. His Lulu was doing horrendous amounts of damage. Although, you know, a lot of it was coming out of Deft as well, who was three hitting tanks. It was just terrifying. But Beast, going to be wandering around here. You can see Energy Pacemaker have got an early invade. Going to be able to scout out any lane swaps towards the top side as Kane and Shu heading towards that top area. And they're opting out of the 2v2, like you mentioned.
Yeah, so they look like they want to dodge that one completely. Don't want to go anywhere near the Jinx Thresh. The Kalista Thresh. The other thing is, and we talk about it a lot, lane swapping is so safe. You're able to get, I guess, farm onto an important carry. You get extra levels, and we've seen time and time again in the LPL, they're willing to let the support stay on level 3, level 4, around that mark. And then give over the level 6 to the AD carries, which is extremely important. Of course, levels just as important as items to be able to scale up into the late game. And from there, because junglers are so top laners are so good at clearing jungle camps, as we take a look at Amazing J just doing that, you really don't lose out on much as a top laner unless you get extremely zoned. So even with a Hecarim who's notoriously bad in 2v1s, they're willing to, I guess, let it get to the point where they're not doing it. And Hecarim probably should have started Wolves because Raptors do a lot of damage and he wasn't able to finish the camp.
Yeah, and Flandre actually has level 2. Might be Twisted advancing onto Raphael here in the mid lane, who's only level 1. He may actually get a flash here. There's actually Flash Twisted advance coming through. There's the Sapling. Raphael taking so much damage. First blood now for Barker. Beautiful play from Snake.
Yeah, definitely was a great gank coming through there. And we see that's the importance of having this lane swap coming through. They get the early invade as well, so going to be able to capitalize on that one, although it is the 2v1 side of the map, and that's fantastic early movement out of Snake. This is what they were missing last time around. They're always starting the game behind, and they're able to, I guess, get to an early lead.
Yeah, and a lot of it had to do with the fact that they were getting dictated to in their last matchup. So now, of course, having so much more control over the game, and they're going to be able to take a very early dragon here as well.
Yeah, they've got the Kalista, so all the Wrens come through. That will do a lot of early game damage, not to mention three fairly tanky members, so they'll take that one away uncontested. You expect that from the lane swap, just moving your duo into the away from the bottom lane if you're Energy Pacemaker, but I don't think you expect the first blood to come through at 2.5 minutes.
Yeah, and Drizzle is going to be able to take away this blue buff, so you get on one health there, a little bit cute, but that is going to mean that the vertical jungling did come through successfully. Two buffs for both of our junglers. But of course, the first blood going to Barker, which is very important. Nice trading to come through with the Qs, but Raphael not going to take it lying down.
Yeah, so going to be able to, I guess, bully back a little bit as we can see the continuation of the double jungle coming through from the Nunu as well as the Hecarim. Members moving into the top lane as well. That's a lot of damage coming through from the Glitter Lance.
Yeah, Raphael doing a lot of poke work with this Lulu. You expect that because, of course, long-range poke with that Glitter Lance, able to clear waves and get a lot of damage down. But Barker, he, of course, hasn't been back yet, hasn't spent that first Blood Golden, continues to have a bit of an advantage as far as that farm.
Yeah, he certainly does. And we see maybe a little bit of a gank squad coming in to to this top lane as three members strong, Flandre, Ella, and Beast moving through the jungle, potentially just looking for Drizzle, trying to get some work done, although they have now spotted him in the bottom side of the map. So, mate, they're looking to break the freeze is exactly what they're doing. They want to make sure that Flandre doesn't get put in the position he was yesterday. We criticize him for holding onto the lane swap a little bit too long. This is the perfect response to a lane swap that has been frozen. Get as many members as you can afford into that lane and push it into the turret. Make sure it hits the turret, so that way it's not going to be frozen on that side of the map for too long.
Yeah, they are going to be able to get rid of all these creeps as well, and Shu and Kane not going to be able to hold that one off. So, successful unfreeze. Thor of the lane, would you call it a Thor?
I like it.
Okay, cool. Thawing the lane there in the top side of the map is Snake. Is Raphael going to continue to clear out these creeps? Barker, of course, going back and augmenting his Hex Core quite nicely. So his wave clear is going to be well improved, assuming he's picked up that Death Ray augmentation.
And look how much more experience they're trying to get into Flandre. They rotate him back into the mid lane as they send Barker back just to pick up the remnants of the wave, because recognizing it's a little bit hard to farm against this Janna Jinx matchup. He grabs a couple of CS there, and now he's going to head back top, and they're pushing the wave at the moment, so he should be fine.
Yeah, and Crystal just happily 1v1ing against Amazing J here as well. Does have a couple of levels on him as the double jungle. Doesn't give you too much experience, but Ella and Flandre up here, just pseudo duo lane with the tree and the Thresh.
Yeah, so this time around, Flandre having a much better game. He's only 6 CS behind, and that's a 7-8 CS wave, so he's going to be able to pick up majority of these, you would think, although back's a little bit too far away. And from there, they're actually sending Ella back to base, so now looking for experience, I guess, more than anything. I do think that they're still struggling in this lane swap situation, but the response today has been much better than it was yesterday.
Yeah, this is a new Snake that we're seeing right here. Proactive plays, making sure that they're getting around the map, mixing it up, and playing as if they're in control, which is what they weren't doing.
And you see the sapling all over the wall, spotting out this invade. You saw the pings go down. They've invaded the blue side of the jungle. Drizzle going to be able to take that one away, but not much danger of being dove just because of that smart sapling. So I really do feel that this is a much better early game out of Snake. They've picked up the first blood. They got the dragon as well, but Energy Pacemaker, they've got a fantastic scaling comp. When you talk about protect the AD carry comps, specifically with someone like a Jinx, throw a Hecarim in there for good measure. The longer this game goes, the better off they're probably going to be.
Yeah, well, it's true. I mean, I guess Snake is relying on Crystal to get huge on this Callista, but it's going to be difficult. Of course, Amazing J playing back very far. He's taking a lot of poke, but Barker clearing out some waves in the mid lane. But yeah, Crystal not really having that opportunity to go for that 2v2 to really dominate that lane.
The thing that concerns me is that Callista is going to be firing into a Nunu.
Yeah, good point.
Who has the snowball, has the ultimate around, going to be able to, Drizzle going to be able to make her life very miserable as we see Amazing J actually taking on Beast here.
Yeah, Beast, of course, only level 4 to the level 5 Amazing J, but Beast is going to be able to flag and drag his way to safety.
Yeah, so this is the danger with hyper carries, is if people start picking up the Nunu, which we're going to see more and more of, because extremely strong on this patch, but you ain't seen nothing until the next one if you are a fan of Nunu's, because he is just so ridiculously strong. And as soon as that snowball comes through, coupled with the ult and a Ranju and Omens or even a Frozen Heart, you just don't attack at all. And that means that Crystal might even have to look at the double attack speed items. We've seen some strange builds come through from the Callista. Thinking about Hurricane, potentially Blade of the Ruined King and the Bloodthirster for all of that. As we see, Flandre actually getting very aggressive in the top lane.
Yeah, Zappy's actually going to find him here, slowing the tree down, but he's just punching Kane. Oh, the Arcane Smash not quite going to be enough. Oh my goodness. Actually, does Kane have level 6? He does. The Super Mega Death Rocket's there. Drizzle's looking for this kill. The teleport out, though. And Flandre's going to be safe.
And they're going to look for a very long time because they wouldn't have expected the teleport to be used. You can see two members still roaming through the jungle thinking, I know he's a tree, but where did he go?
How did we miss him? Was he that wall back there?
So, very heads-up play out of Flandre. I love the W1 and just auto-attack with the low base armor at the start of the game. Maokai's auto-attack is the most devastating part of his kit.
Speaking of devastating, Amazing J has to use that devastating charge to get out of the way of that gank here coming through. The death sentence being used from Ella. Of course, wasn't a gank. It was just a steal away as Drizzle. He's going to take himself a blue buff, and this is what Anunu wants to do. Spend all his time in the enemy jungle.
Yeah, exactly right. Drizzle, he's had that pink ward up for a very long time. The lane swap actually came back through, but his team retaining control over the top side of the jungle.
Yeah, second dragon, though, is going to be available now as Flandre has made his way down. Everyone from Energy Pacemaker seems to be in base, unless it's Drizzle, who's hanging out by the Gromp. And this is going to be the second dragon falling in favor of Snake. Very, very early into the game. They've got a fantastic timing on this. Of course, took the first one at about 3.5 minutes, 9.5 minutes for the second. You can't really get much better than that.
Yeah, and this is really good for Snake because they've got a very good mid-game composition before the Hecarim, the Nunu, gets super tanky. With all the upfront bursts that will come out of the Victor, he's going to be able to set up the Ren sets for Kalista very nicely. So because they've got control over the Dragon Timer, that means they have control over the pace of the game because the fourth and fifth Dragons, so important to contest, but we saw Jinx with the Janna Shield just completely tear through the turret. That's the other dangerous thing. If they focus too much on neutral objectives, start letting turrets fall down, Jinx and Janna push so extremely well.
Yeah, and is the fact that that top out of turret is the fact that it fell down going to be bad here? Because, of course, they have rotated their bottom lane up of Snake, so they were looking to go back into that laning phase 2v2 now that that dragon was off the map.
Yeah, so all they're doing is they're looking to pick as much farm up onto the Kalista as possible. She can't freeze out waves, so it's dangerous to be in that bottom lane where she's going to push up into the enemy jungle. So getting her into a lane, although taking that turret now makes that lane extremely dangerous to be in as well, because the thing about Nunu is you do not want to be in long lanes as an AD carry against the Nunu, because he can just chase you for days. Wails on you with the red buff, throws out all the snowballs with the visionary passive, and really is just a generally annoying champion, I think is the way that you describe Nunu players. They're
yes.
Very annoying.
Yeah. Well, not the players. I'm sure the players are fine, but the Nunu himself, most definitely annoying. But of course, they are free to push up here as Drizzle hanging around in the bottom side of the map, looking to take the next turret down. And if Jinx is good at anything, it's destroying turrets.
Yeah, she's completely non-interactive for the first 20 minutes of the game. That's why I love playing her so much. She just does nothing but shoot creeps and farm turrets. She's extremely good at pushing out the wave. You just saw the rockets coming through. Throw a blood boil on top of her and she's just going to get even more work done. So like what Energy Pacemaker are doing here, they're accelerating the pace of the game to try and get their hyper carries going, and it looks to be working in their favor.
Yeah, Kane continuing the aggression here on the bottom side. Flandre and Beast not looking to go aggressive because, of course, not a lot of vision there on the bottom side of the map. Shu going to come back and just throw that Eye of the Storm onto Kane, going to continue to clear out these waves, and this Jinx really has a lot of tools to get these waves cleared.
Yeah, but Flandre also able to push that wave out, so completely stopping, I guess, the Siege coming through. An Amazing Jay in the top lane. He's having the exact same mission to just try and clear out that wave. AD carry's probably going to rotate into the mid lane relatively soon, but Bakker and Raphael, now that transform, as well as all the AP is about to be picked up for that Morale and Omicron, we'll be able to clear out the lane fairly quickly. So until the next dragon comes up, we might just see some farming.
Yeah, we've got like red and pink lasers going at each other here in the mid lane. That's all that's really happening as Lulu, Glitter Lances, and Barker death rays, and the waves die and they do it over and over again. Of course, very close in farm. Raphael falling a little bit behind now that he's gone back to base, but is most likely going to be able to equalize that pretty quickly as Barker going to follow suit and head back to base as well. Energy Pacemaker, they do pick up that Rift Scuttler.
Would you prefer this a red side. Or a pink laser?
Well, look, I haven't really thought about it.
Think about it now.
Probably a pink laser. I don't know. This feels more fancy.
She's got two as well. I guess Victor only has one.
Yeah. It is called a death ray though. That's pretty badass. Yeah, he's going to be able to clear out this wave here as well as Crystal just going to throw some spears into these minions yet again. Both of these AD carries very strong at the old wave clear. Of course, Kalista has to get relatively close to that minion wave, so having nobody else there is going to be helpful. As Ella's going to land the Descents here onto Drizzle, the box comes through as well. Drizzle taking so much damage as Crystal trying to use the Martial Poise, but it's getting difficult. As Amazing Jay, he comes through, but a beautiful Fate's Call going to knock him up and get him out of there. As Kane was just hovering in the air for some reason. Death Sentence out of nowhere from Ella, and Crystal picks up the kill and now continues the onslaught. Flandre going to fall down. Beautiful polymorph as Crystal now has to get out of there. Double kill for Raphael. There's the gravity field to come down from Barker to disengage the fight, but Crystal a little bit over-aggressive in that one.
Yeah, Crystal got a little bit close to the front of the team fight, and that really cost, but the thing that I really want to point out is the fact that they were chasing a Lulu in a like single file line, and time again, Raphael was like, Here's a four-person Glitterlance. Another three-person Glitterlance. He was doing all the damage in that fight, and that's not what you're expecting from a Lulu. You're expecting Lulu to use that help picks, use the Wild Growth to be able to augment the rest of her team's damage. Raphael just completely tore that fight apart.
Yeah, and I stand by what I said about the pink laser, my friend. Definitely working out here as Raphael actually going to go aggressive on Ibaki here. Ella's hanging around, got those mobility boots. Oh my goodness, that gravity field was beautiful. Easiest death sentence of Ella's life. And Barker picks up the kill.
Yeah, and after I compliment Raphael, he just runs into sure death.
So he needs to even it up.
Yeah.
Even it up.
It was a unique strategy. Didn't pay off this time around. We'll have to keep track and see how it does in future.
Yeah. What, the just die? Yeah. I haven't really seen that one be successful yet. Although I keep going for it myself. Barker now going to clear out this wave yet again. Of course, the double tap of that death ray. Pretty good. Getting rid of these creeps and... he's free to move around this map. 30 seconds on the dragon. And Snake look to have control again, but haven't cleared out the vision just yet. Ella going to try and get rid of this pink ward. But there are a few members of Energy Pacemaker not going to allow him to do that too freely.
Yeah, it certainly looks like this is the one that Energy Pacemaker want to contest. Flandre still in the top lane. He's got this teleport advantage currently, so that's a big deal. Need to watch how Energy Pacemaker respond to that. Do they send Amazing J up there, or are they just going to try and rush down this objective as soon as possible? Looks like they have broken away, so this should be a free dragon. No, Amazing J coming back. Looks like they do want to fight.
Yeah, not going to transition into that outer turret in the mid lane. You can see Energy Pacemaker no vision on Snake, that, you know, Ella popping in and out. But Flandre pushing very aggressively here on the top side. The bottom wave of minions very far towards Energy Pacemaker as Snake. They're hanging around the mid lane now. They may give up this dragon.
Yeah, they certainly look like they might and try and grab two objectives. No teleport coming through.
Yeah, Crystal actually does throw that one down, but Amazing J locks down the dragon. Nice flame trumpets just to try and get Snake out of there. As Ella flashes into the double snare as Amazing J now going to have to be very careful. Chaos Storm there as well, but he's still a gigantic horse in the middle of the fight. Cataclysmed out. And Drizzle trying to get some work done with that absolute zero, but not going to find too much. Flandre, he's found Raphael, but the Whimsy giving him so much movement speed. Flandre has to be careful. The rest of Snake are here. Death Ray, a lot of damage onto Raphael. Energy Pacemaker now need to get out of here because they've lost one. They've lost their big tanky member, and now they're running back towards Snake's base. This is not a good idea.
Yeah, they're going the wrong way, Atlas. Can confirm that is not Energy Pacemaker's base to the left of screen.
No.
However, it looks like they will get away relatively unscathed just going through the jungle. Although Flandre is still trying to corral them. Baka, both summoner spells.
Yeah, actually, yeah, running through their beautiful flame jumpers, and Energy Pacemaker are going on an excursion throughout the base of Snake, and they're actually going to successfully get out.
So that was a 1-0 with Energy Pacemaker picking up the first dragon of the game, which I guess stalls the control that Snake had over that objective. You have to think that even though it was a little bit unorthodox, it was successful.
Yeah, they are going to lose the mid-outer turret, so we can have the discussion about, you know, whether it's worth it considering the fact that, you know, that turret did fall down, but... cue the Benny Hill music, my friend. That was ridiculous.
Yeah, fun to watch as well. So we see Amazing J also did a lot of work in that team fight, even though he got chunked out relatively early. Went in extremely hard afterwards. And you have to think that if Raphael wasn't being zoned by Flandre, would have been a completely different team fight for Energy Pacemaker. So you understand exactly what they are trying to accomplish. The scary thing is, Victor's starting to get extremely fed. And if that's the case, he's going to get people down extremely low at the start of the team fights. And it might not even get to the point where Raphael can hit that really good wild glow growth. We'll have to just stay a little bit too far back to be effective.
Yeah, it might be a little bit more difficult for him. But of course, you know, you can throw Glitterlances out from a very long range. You can help your friends with the picks and then Glitterlance from there. It's just a bit stupid seeing all that damage come through. Those are the double beams of glitter that come down.
Yeah, definitely.
It's such a fancy ability.
It's a very aesthetically pleasing ability. That's what I like about the whole of Lulu's
the diplomatic kit. Response. I like it. Most definitely. But look, I mean, Snake used a whole lot to try and chase Energy Pacemaker, and that was only after getting Amazing J. You have to think Energy Pacemaker are going to be pretty happy about what just went on, because as this game goes further and further ahead, it's just going to get easier and easier for these guys.
Yeah, and that's the thing. They've got the scaling composition, of course. Snake scale well, but they're going to get to a point where Drizzle's just going to be a little bit more effective than Beast is in these team fights, and Kayn is going to scale up to the point where he's a complete nightmare to have to deal with on Jinx.
Yeah.
So you feel that they're both very good comps. One gets to fruition at about the 25 to 30 minute mark, whereas Energy Pacemaker just going to get better and better as the game goes on. This is the thing about top lane carries like the Hecarim, very expensive item build. But when you pick up all the components, he just does a lot of work. Maokai, of course, just going to be useful for that pure tank, especially because it hasn't gone for the Rod of Ages build. We've kind of seen Roa fall out of favor in regards to those top lane Maokai. So going to be pure tank in these situations. Unless he picks up a cheeky Trinity Force in there somewhere.
Yep, the cheeky Trinity Force Maokai, I like it. Doesn't have the Doran's Blades to augment it yet, though, which is a bit unfortunate.
A little bit sad, but...
Yeah.
So, I guess across the board, you just look at Energy Pacemaker's lineup, and they certainly take a little bit longer to get going.
Yeah.
But they outclass Snake in a couple of areas, which I feel are just very important. The movement speed aspect, being able to rotate around the map, the neutral objective control... People talk about how quickly Kalista takes neutral objectives because of the massive shot of Ren, but Jinx in that minigun form completely tears Baron and Dragon apart once she gets that Infinity Edge as well as a Phantom Dancer. So you just... There are so many more win conditions on Energy Pacemaker's side, especially the longer the game goes. And Snake, you feel that like they have a window. They're playing to it currently. Don't get me wrong. 3,000 gold in the lead, 2 dragons to 1, also up a turret. It's just that if things start going a little bit bad, they're... game plan falls apart much quicker.
Yeah, and it just becomes a little bit more difficult for them to achieve what they want to in the late game. So, of course, now looking to try and, you know, show their hand very early on. But we'll see whether it works, because it seems they can't actually chase Energy Pacemaker at all.
Yeah, even after using double summoner spells to jump over a wall and ghost after them.
He got a pretty cool death rate, but I mean, that was about it from Barker, as Kane just going to try and zap him but doesn't find it. And Barker with a very early second augmentation, as we hop over and have a look at the gold, does have 2.2 thousand in the bank. So this Victor probably wants to go back, get a Morella Nomicon, maybe pick up, you know, anything else that he'd like. If he goes back with 28, he might be able to get an Intensely Large Rod at the same time, and that Victor is definitely going to be doing masses of damage. But we shall see. Amazing Jay just going to head back. As Flandre clears out this one, actually decides not to. Does have a level disadvantage that is rectified immediately. That Spirit of Drake going to help him clear out the wave with the Rampage.
Canters away.
Yeah, canters away gloriously into the sunset. Oh, a bit of a reset on this blue buff as Drizzle just sort of standing next to it, hoping that it stops resetting. Raphael is going to eventually secure it and head back towards that mid lane as well. So things calm down just a little bit as Kalista there in the bottom lane. Crystal clearing out wave after wave. Does have a BF sword now, so starting to power up. Is going to have that Bloodthirster very soon.
Yeah, it certainly looks to be going towards that build. Double lifesteal is the potential as well. You have to remember that when you have all these very sticky carries, it is important to be able to stack up the spears for the Ren. So I do like the double lifesteal build coming through here. And we see the continuation of the wave clear in the mid lane versus, I guess, the death ball that's going to come through from Energy Pacemaker. And a little bit of split pushing, trying to get Kalista some more farm until she's got that Bloodthirster. But as we just saw, Vision not being prioritized by either team, really. A lot of dark areas, and that means that they are grouping up and only sending one person to trim the side waves.
Yeah, you can see Snake, they've got a lot of weirdly deep vision, but not a lot of sort of all-encompassing vision. When Energy Pacemaker, a lot of deepness in that vision department. Ooh, Fate's Call actually going to be used to get Ella out of trouble, as Amazing Jay actually teleports into the mid lane. Maybe a little bit too quick on that one. Bit trigger happy was Amazing Jay, because he's not going to find anything from it.
Yeah, they certainly look like they wanted to get a fight started, and you have to question why they're trying to force at this point in the game. They had the teleport advantage for a couple more seconds, could have, I guess, pressured. They were looking for a pick to get themselves in a position to be able to clear out Dragon Vision, I believe, or maybe even push into this mid turret before the next Dragon fight, but in the end, amounts to nothing. Now a huge wave in the bottom lane is going to have to be dealt with from someone in Snake, but... minute 20 until Dragon, they've got time to trim that wave, go back and shop with all the important members, then be back to fight once again.
Yeah, and they can send Kalista down to this bottom lane as well, because Amazing Jay unable to continue split pushing and doesn't have the teleport.
Yeah, so Amazing Jay probably has to go back and buy, you would think. He's actually only got 500 gold, so might look for boots to get that ninja tabi before the next fight, but apart from that, he's pretty much optimal. You see the Zeal coming through, as well as the components of a death cap for this Lulu. Really agree with the flat AP purchases, especially at this point in the game, because going to be able to add a lot through the shield, through the speed up. But Frozen Heart, that's a huge pickup for Flandre. He's going to be difficult to deal with. at best of times for Kane. Really does fall down to Raphael to be able to do that. And Lulu, just not that hyper carry at this point in the game from the mid lane, going to be lacking a lot of damage.
Yeah, it's going to be difficult. Crystal as well, just finished off the Bloodthirster. We've got Morel and Omicron and another needlessly large rod for Barker. Spent that gigantic stack of gold that he had in his back pocket. Beast hanging around here towards this banana brush. Crystal checking that one as well. They don't have too much forward vision as Ella going to be able to clear out this pink ward. And Snake looking to try and continue the push. They, of course, clear waves very, very quickly. And Energy Pacemaker do manage to get some control over the vision around this dragon.
This is the second time Flandre's pulled off incredibly early. Dragon only just spawning, and he had a huge wave crashing into that turret. Could have potentially taken the top lane turret and still made the teleport. Instead, wanted to get his buy-in. It is the home guard boots. He's pinging furiously in the area, probably looking for his teleport to be able to get in there and impact this fight.
Yeah, they don't manage to take down that little ward there as well, as Energy Pacemaker now going to have Vision of Snake. Amazing J is here. Blood Boil on the horse, actually. It's a little bit interesting. Is Barker going to clear out the rest of the bottom wave and make his way back?
Flandre is still in base, just sitting there patiently, waiting for the teleport to come through.
Waiting for the opportune moment.
Really values the home guards. There he is.
Yep, here he is. Glitterlance going to stop his party there a little bit. Zap actually taking off about half of his health here as Flandre trying his very best to hold on to this one. Callista locking down that Dragon Drizzle, taking so much damage. Absolute Zero only onto Beast there as well as Amazing J. He's falling incredibly low. Beast does eventually die as Kane managing to rip through the team, but now finds himself in no man's land. The flash forward Crystal rends him to death. The double kill now for this Callista as the Fate Score comes down from Ella and Shu. He has to get out. Raphael, no more mana left, and Snake, a 3-for-2.
Yeah, and that was all about Crystal going super aggressive onto Kane in the Dragon Pit, tearing him apart in the end. Just way too much damage output coming through. And they're putting a lot onto Amazing J, who's diving into the back line, but he's just not lasting long enough by himself. Drizzle needs to get back in there. They need to go together or not at all, you feel, and just peel for this Jinx, because every single team fight, Crystal just getting more done.
Yeah, well, this is the thing, and Drizzle that fight used Absolute Zero on just a Jarvan and then had to run away because he'd taken way too much damage. I think it had a lot to do with Barker almost chunking him out completely by himself.
Yeah, and Barker at this point, very strong. 3-1-4, can go back with some more gold if he so pleases. Has roughly 1,800
still.
That's
a death cap. That's terrifying. This Victor is going to be two items at 24 minutes. Has that death cap, well, three items actually, because that's 2,000 gold worth of hex core augmentation. This Victor is massive right now.
Yeah, he's pretty big, and we've seen that he's just continuing to clear waves in this mid lane. He's built himself up a 40 CS advantage, and that was the third dragon going over for Snake as well. So they're still on track for a 32-minute fifth dragon, which is surprisingly early in the game, especially when you consider that the other team has picked up a dragon themselves.
Yeah, and Crystal now, he's going to be able to go back and pick up a Last Whisper outright. So the next fight, this Callista is going to be doing silly things as well.
Yeah, so across the board, you feel that now Snake are in a position to really take control of the game. We mentioned that they've got a win condition of about 30 to 40 minutes if they want to be stronger around the map. As we see a little bit of a siege coming through in the mid lane, using that couple of shields to try and get some last turret shots in from Kane before they retreat away from the team fight. And yeah, it really looks like between the 25 and 40 minute mark, this game is all about Snake. They're exactly where they want to be. 6,000 gold in the lead.
Yeah.
Means that they're a couple of items ahead, and now it's all about the stall. Can they stall out, wave clear on Energy Pacemaker side, not give up the Baron, you feel, that's extremely important, and wait for Kane to get to that 3-4 item mark as Jinx. And you see that he's already critting for a lot of damage, and that's only with the Infinity Edge and Zeal. We'll continue to scale up as this game goes on.
Yeah, and that's Barker going back, picking up that Rabidan's Death Cap and some Lucidity Boots here as well. Got a lot, that's, you know, 40% CDR without a blue buff already on this Victor, and has so much ability power. But I just want to have a look at Flandre here just for one moment. He's over 50 CS in the lead after a lane swap against a split-pushing Hecarim.
Yeah, and has, I guess, been able to secure teleport advantage more times than what Amazing J has. Has used his teleport to much greater advantage, only using it around the dragon objective, whereas Amazing J was looking for ganks, and that really cost him the ability to be able to sit in the top lane and farm up alongside Flandre. We saw Flandre, both Dragon Fights, the last two Dragon Fights, has just been able to push the lane from base all the way into the top lane turrets, completely uncontested as the catch comes through.
Yeah, Shu taking so much damage from that Pierce as Ella's going to throw down the box. Fate's Call going to save his life as Kane can use those Flame Choppers. As Flandre, he's all the way in here as well. There's the horse into the backside as Crystal gets exhausted. He takes so much damage here. Is going to fall down, but they trade for the horses. The Chaos Storm ripping everyone apart. Energy Pacemaker get destroyed. And that looked great. I mean, they killed the Kalista, but you have to think that Barker doing a lot of damage.
Yeah, and this was the problem. We said that it was a two damage threat and they needed Barker to be the one to chunk people out. He's really rolling at this point in the game. 5-1-4, just picks up another double kill. And the reason that fight looked better for Energy Pacemaker, Drizzle and Amazing J were on the back line. The snowballs were coming through. Raphael had the help picks on Amazing J, was able to get some Glitter Lances across. Problem is, just way too much damage now coming through from Victor, who was allowed to get so far ahead.
Yeah, now has a Sheen as well. So this Victor is going for the Ultra Burst damage.
I disagree with that build at the moment. Needs to pick up a Void Staff probably as soon as possible. And that's just setting himself a little too far behind. Could have had both components. And we'll take a look at the replay here as we see a catch coming through onto Shu. So he took a lot of his health at the start of the fight. And Flandre absolutely flies into the back line as we see him get on top of Kane. From here, it's all about the fact that they were able to get both members onto Crystal. You see the snowball coming through, all the damage coming out from Amazing J, but Flandre and Beast were able to tank up the back line for long enough for Barker to get the perfect Chaos Storm out across the whole of the team, and now they're going again.
Yeah, actually, there's the death sentence onto Raphael. Gets immediately exploded. Kane forced to use that flash to get out, and beautiful Howling Gale. We'll see whether it's actually going to be enough here, and it is. Energy Pacemaker, they escape, but they lose the Lulu.
Yeah, and potentially the Baron Atlas. They're streaming towards that objective. Complete denial of vision. They know they didn't walk around the corner, so they're not in the Baron pit, but once they go in there, still 20 seconds on the support.
Yeah, and Scrying Orb was just used there by Kane. Spotted out the fact that Snake were hanging around. And they are going to head down towards this dragon here as well. 3 seconds. Fourth dragon now for Snake at 29 minutes into the game. And they're not going to be able to get contested for this one. This is definitely theirs.
And once again, they have the teleport advantage. So Flandre able to sit in that top lane, farm up even more CS. They've got this AD carry currently soloing at that out. They've picked up an extra 3 turrets as well whilst accruing all these small advantages across the map. And all of a sudden, what was a close game, 8,000 gold the lead and 4 dragons at 29 minutes for Snake.
Yeah, and Snake just really utilizing the fact that you mentioned, like, what was it, 26 minutes is when they were going to be very strong. I believe it was 26 minutes that they really managed to take victory in those team fights. So knew exactly when they were powerful. Unfortunately, weren't able to save this outer turret in the mid lane as a couple of members did go back after that dragon. QSS now complete for Crystal. That's huge.
Yeah, QSS is fantastic pickup here on Kalista. As we see the teleport actually coming in from Maokai, they might have been caught here.
Yeah, Flandre looking for something, gets caught by the Flame Chompers. There's the Monsoon, actually, as Flandre demanding so much respect from this Energy Pacemaker lineup. He's heading back. Interesting. Snake, try and get some vision over this wall here, and they're going to start up the dragon.
Yes.
The Baron, sorry.
So they're starting up Baron, and they're ripping through it completely. No vision, already at half health.
Cool. Super Mega Death Rocket does come through. Crystal does get feared up here as well as Amazing J trying to get the damage down. There's the Ren that takes down the Baron. Drizzle, there's an absolute zero, but not going to do enough here at all as Amazing J is going to get the Wild Growth. Kane picks up a kill there onto Kalista, is going to die for it in response as Raphael, he falls down. Barker still at basically full health. Amazing J, Barker doesn't quite manage to land the E, but there's the gravity field, the death sentence, and Snake. That's a 4-for-1.
And this is why I was questioning the draft that came out of Energy Pacemaker. You saw a deliberate win condition executed yesterday from Vici Gaming that was do not let Barker and Crystal get too comfortable champions, because they're the hard carries for the team. This is the way that Snake have proven they want to play. As soon as they got the Victor and the Kalista, you see how much more comfortable they are team fighting. Yesterday, they were in complete disarray. today they've controlled all the dragon objectives with apart from one. They've baited Vision much better, and their two carries are once again looking brilliant in these team fights.
Yeah, and as soon as Barker gets a comfort pick, I mean, we were talking about the fact, oh, Barker not looking so great yesterday. He was playing Ezreal and Zed. It's not the Viktor, it's not the Xerath that he has shown so much incredible prowess. It's not difficult to get rid of two champions. There's a ban phase.
Yeah, there is, and it just wasn't utilized fully in this matchup. So Energy Pacemaker, they have to look at this game and think, we picked away the Nunu. We didn't want that to be the objective. We went for a little bit of a hyper carry composition against a team that obviously knows how to play hyper carry compositions and just hasn't worked out in their favor. Now Hecarim, he's got two defensive items. I agree with the build Amazing Jay's gone, because going the Trinity Force just would have meant that he is too squishy in this lineup. However, he's not got enough damage to be able to deal with both the Viktor as well as the Kalista. And it's just not going to get any better from here.
Yeah, and that's an 815 ability power Viktor here as well. Has the Lich Bane, has the perfect Hex Core here as well. So that Gravity Field going to be pulling people to the middle, and it's also going to increase that Chaos Storm's movement speed by 20%, which is huge.
Yeah, and I'm going to call this the extremely confident Viktor build, because he needs a Void Staff.
Yes.
And has no escapes.
Hey, no. You get movement speed from your Q, man.
And he's going to have no defensive item. So I'm going to call it the extremely confident Viktor.
Yep. Yeah, that is... Okay, I think you can get away with that. But he does a heck of a lot of damage.
If anyone goes near him, he's going to kill them. The problem is, if he gets caught out, going to die extremely quickly. Nose on his hourglass, no defensive items, along with no penetration in the build.
Yeah, and no fear at all as he's walking into the base of Energy Pacemaker at the front of his team.
Yeah, so going in solo, they're going to look to pick up the first inhibitor of their game. They
Whoa,
grab it.
That Lich Bane was tearing through that inhibitor. Easily picks that one up. Snake now going to transition towards this bottom side. They still got a bit of Baron left over. As Flandre just going to take a dark passage to safety. Inner turret is going to fall here very quickly.
Barker is 4,000 gold ahead of Raphael.
That is ridiculous. Flandre, there's the Ventral Maelstrom here as well. Just the Maokai standing in the front line. Zap not going to find the target. And it is going to be Barker picking up that last objective. Look at this amount of damage coming through from that Lich Bane. Just every time Barker hits it, so much damage. Energy Pacemaker doing their very best to try and stall, but they lose the second inhib without any response.
And two inhibs down, they back away because Baron has expired, but it's only a minute until Dragon. All they have to do is keep control of the area, make sure they have some wards down, go back, spend up all that gold that they just grabbed, and then they can look for the last team fight with double inhibs down and fifth Dragon buff.
Yep, two inhibs down, fifth Dragon buff. Baron, not an option here, but they are going to be able to siege out the top wave in sort of tutorial style here for Snake. It'll take a miracle for Energy Pacemaker to come back through in this one. But we spoke about the fact that, you know, if Snake don't manage to close this game out, you know, if it gets to 80 minutes, it's going to be pretty difficult to beat the Energy Pacemaker lineup.
Yeah, it certainly is. I don't think it needs to go quite to the 80-minute mark. If they make it to 50, I think Energy Pacemaker will win. But this game looked like it's going to end at about the 39 minutes, because 30 seconds until Dragon's up. I'll give him 2 minutes to position around an objective and then maybe a minute to smack him.
Okay, you heard it here first, ladies and gentlemen. Spawn giving Snake a timer on Smack and Energy Pacemaker. 7-1-7 now for Barker. Does have a 50 CS advantage, more than. No Void Staff yet complete for Raphael, which is going to be his third item here by the looks of things, and that's almost the sixth item for Barker.
Yeah, so Barker, an extreme amount of gold ahead, nearly 5,000 gold at this point, and they're going to look to pick up this. Oh, teleport coming through. They're completely caught out of position.
Yeah, Flandre zooming into the backside of this potential team fight. There's the Ventral Maelstrom. Flandre just CCing Energy Pacemaker for days. Kane, he gets hit by the Death Sense, but Ella finds his way in there as well. Twisted Advance gonna get him amongst it as Beast trying to kill the Jinx, but he's not taking too much damage, does eventually go down, and Crystal, he's still alive at full health. Drizzle, no mana. Raphael is running so fast away from that team fight, and you have to think, trying to run away from the game itself, because after that fight, you have to think Snake are going to be able to pull this one out.
Yeah, certainly looks like that's going to be the case. All the meanwhile, super minions in the base taking out the Nexus turrets. Snake going to pick up a game in very emphatic fashion. 17,000 gold is their lead. And that was very well executed.
Yeah, and we were waiting until the snake that we knew and loved comes back, and they weren't here yesterday, but ladies and gentlemen, they have returned today. You can see Crystal, bit of a grin on his face as well. He had a brilliant game on that Kalista. And man, if Snake get their comfort picks, they look good.
Yeah, they certainly do. All of a sudden, 100 CS advantage in the top lane. Flandre back to his usual form.
Oh yeah.
And comfort picks in the mid and AD carry positions are really an unforgivable mistake now at this point, you feel, with any team Pacemaker just not respecting what other teams are doing to control Snake, thinking they have their own game plan and not being able to execute.
Yeah, and the Diana ban came through from Snake as well. That was a bit interesting. We haven't actually seen Raphael on that champion yet, but of course, they know each other a little bit better than we do. They are able to practice against one another, and maybe that's something that Raphael's picked up, something that Amazing Jay's picked up here as well, and we'll see whether it comes through again.
Because it outright beats Victor.
Ah, it's the victim, is it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, cool. Well, I learned something here today, ladies and gentlemen. But we are going to be having game two coming up between Energy Pacemaker and Snake very, very soon. Don't go anywhere.